So welcome everyone to Bedlam in the Virtual World, co-hosted by the WCPA, the Worcester County Poetry Association, and big thank you to Bob for running the technical side of the house. I have been running him ragged with my ambitious Zoom planning of poetry readings, and I'm probably going to slow it down to like two a month going forward, including the open mic, the Deep Thoughts open mic. So that's kind of where my head is at. But I would really like to see these continue. They've been very successful. A lot of people have tuned into them. And if you just heard me, as I was saying to Eve, they're so unifying and connecting, especially in this time when we're spending so much time at home. But just in general, I've been surprised how much I've liked this. I was so resistant to the idea at first because I was like, no, poetry reading has to be in person. But there's been some benefits to this. And, you know, it's that wider reach, that wider unification. So thank you all for tuning in. That being said, I would like to get started and introduce both of tonight's poets to you guys, and they're going to kind of do a little sort of round robin. They're going to do 10 minutes between them and flip-flop back and forth. So because of that, I'm going to read both of their bios right now, and then I'm basically going to turn it all over to them. So Jenith Charpentier is the author of three chapbooks: Bending the Water Between Us from 2011, Bad at Gravity from 2013, and Five Poems by Jenith Charpentier from Damfino Press from 2015. And that is the book that is for sale on our website. She represented Worcester's Poets Asylum at the 2012 Individual World Poetry Slam, and as a member of the 2013 National Poetry Slam team. She was a judge for the Rabbit Heart Poetry Film Festival in 2014, 2016, and 2017. Her poetry appears in several publications, including OVS, Mas Tequila Review, Wicked Banshee Press, The Orange Room Review, Worcester Magazine, Tipton Poetry Journal. She has also served as a local organizer of Worcester's Seven Hills Slam, Worcester Women Poets, and Ballard Street Poetry Journal, as well as several workshops and courses on poetry. So welcome, Jenith. I'm very excited to have you here, and I've seen you read out and about several times, and I'm really excited to have you reading for Bedlam tonight.
Thank you.
Joe Fusco Jr. Did I say that right? Fusco or Fusco?
It doesn't matter.
Oh, you go by both?
I can go by both, sure. I've been called a lot worse, sure.
Okay. Joe is a well-seasoned poet, humorous grocer from Worcester, Mass. He is the author of three somewhat amusing collections of poems and essays. I think he's editorialized this a little. They are That's Different, published this year in 2020, and that book is for sale on our website. Three Score, published in 2014, that is also for sale. And The Lost Then Found Essays of Joe Fusco Jr. from 2012. As well as six earlier chapbooks. Joe's musings have appeared in Worcester Magazine, in fact, just recently. What was it, last week, Joe, that you had something? Damfino Press, Ballard Street Poetry, Worcester Review, AsinePoetry.com, and the e-zine Clean Sheets. He was the winner of the last Worcester Mega Slam in 2017. Joe and Cindy have lived in Worcester with their large family for 34 years. They have a one-car garage. It's details like that that we need to know. So I'm going to turn it over to both Joe and Jenith Jenith, and I will be pasting a link where you can go to our online store and buy their books. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Nicole. I've bought some books from Bedlam so far, and I heard people talking about reading in the time of coronavirus. It's a great local bookshop. I think I got my books like the next day or something after ordering online. And granted, the postal service only had to bring them probably 2 miles, but it was good. I'm excited that you're able to do curbside now. That's great. Okay. So Joe, just to give you a heads up, I'm doing 5 poems in each section, and I think that's about 10 minutes each. So if you want to count, but anyway. It was really warm today, so I'm actually kicking off with a poem that's set in August. August woman, you claim to hate this month. Pungent steam, sauna thick from the hot street. City's congestion closing in on your skin. You close your eyes to it. When you were young, you spent summer nearly naked. Took a job stocking supermarket freezers, found relief at the pool, the library. Now you melt into it, pour lemonade, drop bits of ice into your cleavage, sit out on the stoop, legs spread, long skirt, fleshy knees. In wet heat, waiting for the storm to come, rupture the swell. You can't see the lightning, hear it snaking the sky, while clouds grope for a compromise. Scattered rumbling sharpens to an explosive crack. Rain bursts soak your scalp, brings the taste of salt to your lips. Limber in the moment, you arch your back, press your torso against the deluge, free your hair from its clip. Let your head fall. Your eyes glimpse blue in the gray sky, still grumbling further off. It will be over so quickly. You lay back on the steps, open your mouth, drink in all you can hold. And then, sorry, I just wanted to do one technical note. I am sitting outside. Is the wind too noisy?
We don't hear the wind, at least I don't, but you did break up a little bit.
Okay, I don't know how much I can do for that, sadly. Right. More info. The first kiss is fiction. My lips, a yaga hungry, and no way to open the door. I am your wandering house. I built these pliant walls to shelter all the secrets you want. I am your magic comb. Lay me down, conjure elm and cherry. I am the escape you want. I am your thin black cat surviving to spite you. I don't care that I'm not the love you want. Riddles are for children. Kindness is for weaklings. I can give you teeth of iron. Kiss me. Let's see. The fitting. Moon changer. Firstborn of my socket womb, steady your laced cage. Clarion ox bears a babe erelong. My needle mouth prayer rings blood from honeyed fists. Weight is a groom banging tea stains from clouds. Shelter your bloom from his wretched throat. I've woven my hair into darts and cleats. Break my velvet chair, kindling my legs, set fire to the cloakroom. You are no girl. Swallows mourn your bending spine. I have calloused your feet. Let us hold each other breast to breast. There is mending not yet done. thistles unfold. I once sold a kiss and bought a dream that is ending. Let's finish this dress before we grow old. That was a sonnet that I wrote when I was making an Easter dress for my oldest, and realized that I couldn't use little kid patterns anymore. Turning moments kind of thing. Breaking. She does not have a predictable heart. There are no tide tables or moon charts to navigate her twisting channels. Where she is deep, she narrows. Pathways full of whirlpools, muscles, shells, neutron stars. She knows the moon is an imposter. Gravity has left her shores unaltered, cannot move a body that's not real. She does not have a predictable heart. She is centered on lead. Her spine arcs from neck to tailbone. Her loose arms encircle bent legs that she's pulled to her empty chest. She is spiral, incident, voyage, shipwreck, small part. She does not have a predictable heart. Let's see. And then the last one for this first round. At the arcade, I put a 20 in the change machine and get back one tube of high voltage red. My pinup lips start all games chirping. I can drive a car with the arch of my foot while throwing barrels of syrup at an overlit skyline and kissing the milkman. There is a line for the basketball hoop, and I am afraid of horses, but these stilettos fit like the crown prince of Norway. Women I've ever loved beat me at Dance Dance Revolution. Once, I took a jazz class and wore nothing but hot pink sequins to bed. I like the way my heels click, clack, and never call home. My new lover makes me vegan brunches before bringing me to play Big Buck Hunter. I prefer air hockey, but she likes to watch me shoot. These are the easy trades. It is harder to decorate our apartment with lighthouses from behind this butcher's apron. I keep saying next Wednesday, and she keeps handing me plastic rifles. Last week, I met up with an old friend who likes to tilt tables. We blew 1,000 for kisses over the goal line and came up tied. This morning's pancakes taste like fire engines. It is so strange to, like, it's awesome to see your faces. It's very strange to not hear people while reading to them. That was the end of my first 10, so I'm going to pass it off to you, Joe.
Okay, thank you, Jenith. Everybody hear me okay? Sound okay? Okay.
Yep.
I have people in the house, so it might get in a dog, so might get a little complicated. Now the real serious stuff is coming right now, so put on your thinking caps. This is a lot of the stuff from my new book. Again, you can buy it through Bedlam. You know, buy it through Nicole, buy Jenith through Nicole. It helps them out. You know, get a gift certificate from them. We've got to support local businesses right now. Really, really have to do that. A lot of my stuff talks about growing old uncomfortably. And this is called a futura. My grandmother died at the ripe old age of 99 in 1999. And I was her oldest and favorite grandchild. My grandmother had an Italian saying that she invoked when people questioned her actions, opinions, or decisions. Ma, you shouldn't serve the men food before the rest of the family, my aunts would tell her. A futura, my grandmother would reply. Julia, you need to take the pills I prescribe for you every day, her doctor would insist. Ah, futera, my grandmother would tell him. Mrs. Fusco, you can't touch every peach that I have on the stand, the corner grocer would plead. Ah, futera, my grandmother would say. Now I Googled a futera. I found no such word in the Italian-English dictionary. My 82-year-old aunt believes it was one of the many Italian expressions my grandmother just made up. It meant, screw you, or go to hell, or who are you, what to tell me what to do, my aunt translated. Your grandmother also had a saying, effondo giddy app, which meant, you're a horse's ass. Now, I believe my wife and I have reached the afutera stage of our lives. At and over 60, we find our actions, words, and decisions becoming increasingly unfiltered. You spend too much time at the casino, our children scold us. Afutera, we reply. You guys certainly like your Tangerean wine, our friends chide us. Afutera, we tell them. You can't stop coming every week. We're finally making progress, our therapists implore us. Ah, futera, we tell her. Now, last week, a local politician rang our bell and spent 15 minutes explaining why he was so much better than his opponent. Do I have your votes in the primary, he finally asked us. Fondo giddy app, we replied. And then we closed the door. Thank you. Here's another piece about growing old uncomfortably, and it's some senior male angst. After reading, well, it'll explain itself. It's called Once is Enough. Then they made love again. What a load of rubbish. And from authors I admire like John Irving, Robert Parker, Hemingway. Fact is, once the hero reaches a certain age, no matter how macho, he doesn't make love again, willingly. He gets up and takes an Ambien with a glass of milk. He cuddles till his wife falls asleep, then catches the fourth quarter of the Lakers game. He skips through the obits looking for familiar faces while on the john. At a certain age, why tempt fate? Thank your God it went well for 9 minutes. Hope your mate feels the same and move on. Move on. You're not freaking 18 anymore with a V8 under the hood, Mario Andretti. Be thankful that old Sparky started up, didn't stall, sputtered across the finish line. Fact is, once you reach a certain age, just planning to make love is exhausting. Homework done, check. Kids asleep, check. Mother-in-law tranquilized, check. Shower and shave, floss, test the batteries, visualize. By the time foreplay begins, you're like a boxer in his corner before the 12th round bell. Then they made love again. Bullshit. Why not? They kissed softly. She rolled over on his side. He put on his anti-snoring device and they slept happily ever after. The end. Thank you. Got a couple of summer pieces. This is an older poem. It was published a long, long time ago in Worcester Magazine. Kids were young. It's called The Not So Great Outdoors. The rose bush in our backyard blooms briefly in mid-June. Its rich burgundy petals remind my wife of the other rose bush I weed whacked the first summer we moved in 2 years ago. Now the rose bush blooms again briefly in mid-August. Reminds my children of the vinyl pool I weed whacked on a steamy Saturday afternoon last year. I can still see the four of them standing like tiny passengers on the Titanic as the Disney characters deflated. This spring, the weed racker remains in the cellar because I caught the outdoor extension cord with the hedge trimmer. My wife swears the neighborhood holds its collective breath when I venture outdoors on a weekend. Screw them. In September, I'm getting every inch of vegetation blacktopped. Thank you. Gonna do one more, another short one, another short summer one. It's when we went on vacation a few years back. I hope some of the references aren't that dated. I mean, there's some older people on this, so some of you will get it. If not, read the footnotes. It's called Chatham. A short man walks his large dog on the beach at dusk. He's a year-rounder who likes to chat with tourists about Chatham. Your dog looks like a coyote, my wife tells him. He's half coyote, the short man replies. Now our children climb the empty lifeguard chair and they Geronimo into the sand. What's his name? I ask. Bundy, the year-rounder replies. Oh, like Al, Unmarried with Children, I ask? No, like the serial killer, he replies. We grab the children and hurry back to the cottage, locking the windows, pulling a heavy desk behind the front door. The night is starless and silent, except for an occasional shout from the beach. Here, Ted, and like a worried roadrunner, I sleep with one eye open, waiting for the wild coyote to strike. Thank you. Again, buy some books, buy some gift certificates. I'm turning it over to you again, Jenith.
Thanks, Joe. Coming to you live from the other end of the street.
Yes, I keep waiting. Do people know that we live on the same street?
I don't know if they know that.
Really? Yeah. I love it. It's like a neighborhood reading.
Yeah.
Yes, I biked him some tomatoes the other day. So that's another plus of quarantine. My car was in the shop for almost 3 weeks, and I didn't really care. I kept forgetting that I even ever needed to go anywhere ever. So, also, it's nice to know that there's other people out there running over for their electric cords. Because I do that too. All right. So I think the five in this piece of the set are kind of made up mythologies. I like that idea, that genre. The naming. In the beginning is my father, and my father is a spade. I am a small hole in the dirt and a promise of fava beans. My mother brings water and a wish for sunflowers. I am twitching roots, snaking green tendrils, seeking the sun. My brothers are born as half-eaten tomatoes and abandoned apple cores, small fingers scrounging for worms beneath my rose. I learn to use what I am given, to provide what is needed from what is not. I find a husband by not finding a husband. I am a bed, a meal, a shelter, a wife. My children claw and crawl from my angles, pumpkins, butterleaf lettuce, a spruce tree. I have stopped searching for the sky. I forget each season as it passes and forget again with each year. In the end, it is the sky that finds me. She settles beneath my twisting vines, presses her light full into my shade. Woman, she whispers into the clay of me. I feel my heartbeat in the flat of her palm. A brief history of gravity. It was the people of the country, acne and hot liquid, tea clouds, edges permeable and melting, lit the horizon. Ice met each body afloat. Good, dangerous affairs. Rates of falling people and cookies were tracked separately. Aid ministers voided your bias. It grew not to fight, but it would not. They began to fill themselves with iron-shaped parts, so bullish. Earth became sacred, became the desire to jump. That one was from a course that I took in January, and we were playing with a tool that's kind of fun. If you haven't done this before and you want a new thing to play with in poetry, you take something that you've written and run it through a translator and then run it through another translator. So I think that one went through Icelandic and Czechoslovakian and a couple other languages and then back. So you get just some interesting imagery where you don't have direct translations and then replay with that. It's just, I don't know. If you're a word nerd, it's a fun thing to do. What of me is legacy? We can already see their death coming as we plant the seedling. Encircle her in chicken wire, bring water. This is a hospice childhood, readying your bark for the lean times. We tried once to write poetry that would last as long as the stars, but we gave up counting wishes when the last tomato refused to sprout. There are still things to eat and feed each other, but none as reliable as that red flesh once was. I heard someone say that the taste was acidic, and I think our understanding of acid used to be quite limited. Look at you, sprouted blessing, your limbs making ash into fingers and veins. There was a time called daylight once. You would have loved it, the plenty and warm of it. Even now, I see you delight in the nutrients you collect through your toes, curled into the sponge of what once was, pulling beauty from a depth I cannot fathom in its shallowness. This seems illogical to me. Me, who once dove among the darkest creatures of the sea, those who make their own light and spark, who define beauty apart from sky and yet beneath it still. When I think of seeking nourishment, I think of travel. I think of journey and space, of not finding what I need over and over until my feet are blister sore and obstinate. But you, little one, you have sent yourself long and deep where you stand. Unearthed is not your word. Instead, you have joined to that which is earth. You let nourishment come to you. I do not know how. What is this feeling called home? What is this calling felt sky? Even in wanting to know, my body is wondering about the next one like you and where to find them and how they are different, how they are the same. It seems you may be too busy growing there at your own slow pace, and I am too impatient. Maybe later, when you are faster and I am still, I am curious. If I became as earth for you, could you teach me who I am? Tell me what of me is legacy, what is not. So I'll go from that, which was sort of like story poem, into this, which is a year in tweets. Back when tweets had to be a certain length, I did this exercise. So I think it was like 2013. They don't have to be short anymore, but anyway. April's Fool. What is the word for inertia? The one that rhymes with failure and coward. The one that starts with a B, like baby and bystander. May I? No. Nope. Never. No. Not. Nope. No. 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 June. I am a mundane thing. Lawnmower. gas can, $5 bill, dirty shoe, looking for beauty. Here's my wasting, how it sneaks, green as grass. Iowa in summer. Grief, hot metals my skin, pools my organs at my bone toes. Only taut cords remain to tin whale and name me monster, monster, monster. August. I write myself a shot of whiskey and a werewolf, start counting the days till my next meal. My 41st birthday. I miss the woman I wanted to become as though I had been alive once. I dress myself in morning clothes. My children still eat cake. October. Light cycles throw me off my tack. Hello, dark skies. Earn my candles at wit's end. Hold on to brightness and hold back. The anniversary of the shooting of President Kennedy. Not once, not clear, not scream, not reason, not breathe, not hear, not touch, not rain, not scrape, not clean, not stop, not see, not night, not not. Christmas. I forget to account for the weight of her past on my tongue. Catch myself slurring my words. January. He, lentil soup kiss, warm and husk. She, yesterday's cordwood, rank and wormy. He, hollow, sunbeam and yellow. She, nest, mudspit and screech. February. March. Each spring the buds unfold and I am transfixed, as though something besides leaf could happen, as though that is not enough miracle. Okay. And the last of this bit, spell casting. You ask me for legs, runner's legs, fishnet stocking legs, lightning legs, lightning legs. You say you are trying to surface your heartbeat. I ask to see your tongue. Your eyes glisten with tears. An involuntary hum vibrates from your lips. I cup your chin. You want me to confirm I am not a dentist. I let you bind my hands. When you open yourself to me, you are pale, like a sandstorm. This will require both of your ears and most of your attention. You give me your hands, palms up. I grant you four lemons. I grant you four lemons. You meet my gaze. Your beauty is in its fullness. You think this has nothing to do with legs, but you are wrong. Tie back your hair with a piece of mother's lace and picture your father holding you when you were three. Go out on the coldest morning of the week. At dawn, squeeze the lemons into the street. Walk exactly 1 mile. Drop the emptied fruit. Leave them. Walk home. Do not look at your feet for 3 days. By the fourth morning, you will forget to doubt your strength. Your beauty is in its fullness. You thought this had something to do with legs, but you were wrong. That is it. Thank you. Passing it back to you, Joe.
Thank you. Thanks, Jenith. Okay. You know, it's tough to be an alleged humorist on Zoom, because you know you don't really get a reaction, and for a lot of you I don't even see your faces, so you know, if you don't mind showing yourself for this final 10 minutes, I would appreciate that. Drinking a new gin tonight, aviation gin. My son-in-law turned me onto it. It's after about the fourth or fifth one, it's really good. Yeah. Okay, this is a poem I wrote at the, anybody familiar with Worcester? I wrote this at the old Gil Rains, when Mike Duffy used to have the Falconet there. And unfortunately, in a way, it's semi-prophetic, and you'll see at the end of it, but it's called 967 Main Street. I want to own the storefront at 967 Main Street. It's just a storefront. There's no building behind it. It's a real fixer-upper. I want to own the storefront at 967 Main Street, put my family name in broken neon lights. Every night we could look up and see O's. It's a retailer's dream come true. I want to own the storefront at 967 Main Street, pull down the heavy metal overhead to protect the plywood from graffiti. It's a fairly expressive neighborhood. Now, I want to own a business behind the storefront at 967 Main Street, a drive-up funeral parlor called Grieve and Leave. It's for mourners who don't have much time or really didn't like the deceased but must pay their respects. We'll prop the body in a big picture window. You'll drive by, punch your PIN number onto the guest list, exit guilt-free. Light refreshments will be available at the second window. Now, I have a dream that begins behind the storefront at 967 Main Street. Thousands of grieve and leave drive-up funeral parlor franchises dotting the urban landscape. The name Fusco synonymous with death like Dunkin' with donuts. You say it can't be done. This is America, where poor taste and perseverance do not go unrewarded. Thank you. Now, my wife Cindy and I are going to be married close to 34 years. Anybody who knows her knows she is the much better half of the relationship. This is kind of the beginning of our story. It's called Fitzy's Pub. So here we are, 32 years later, pulling into a handicapped parking space in front of Fitzy's Pub, hitting the curb where we sat and got to know each other for 3 hours after last call, 1 a.m. to 4 a.m. in the spring of 1984. I was the store manager of the supermarket across the street, youngest store manager in the chain, a shooting and or falling star. You were a recent hire in the bakery department, perky, personable, and positive, the three P's, with an uncanny ability to decorate cupcakes. Now, I drank every night after work at Fitzy's. Tanqueray in a glass, first marriage on the rocks. Sometimes I would spice things up with a Bud Light chased with a shot of Anisette to honor my Italian heritage. You came into the pub one Saturday night with some other employees, green slit skirt, ordered white Zinfandel. I told the bartender to put it on my tab. Everyone put it on my tab. I was out of work with 1 week with a back injury, came back to a $292 bill. You objected. Paid your own way, Ms. Independence. Per my weekend routine, I sauntered onto the dance floor, unlit cigarette dangling from my mouth, moonwalked unsteadily to Billie Jean. Later in the evening, we slow danced to Every Breath You Take. What a great love song, I slurred. It's about a stalker, you replied. You enchanted me, fiery, Festy, whatever that is, fantastic. The three F's, seeing behind all my bullshit. I never talked to anyone for three straight hours. There were times where I didn't talk a total of 3 hours in a month, but my life story poured out of me that night, and your life story seeped out of you. And we listened. We truly listened to each other. So we kept meeting at Fitzy's Pub, Tanqueray with ice, then ice and lime, till you told me you'd rather not meet at a bar. So we met elsewhere, and I fell in love with you, and out of love with alcohol. Now it's 32 years, 4 children, 5 grandchildren later. Meeting best friends at Fitzy's for dinner before heading off to Plain Ridge Casino. Yes, we still have some vices. They've added a function room, sports memorabilia, and 300 freaking TVs. It's cleaner. Food's still mediocre. I ordered a Tanqueray and tonic, extra lime. You get a Chardonnay. We toast the new year and I silently thank the gods for that talk on the curb so long ago. Feeling lucky tonight, you ask? Oh yeah. Oh yeah, I reply. Thank you. And I can do a, whoops. Okay, so I've got a couple of COVID pieces, I guess. And again, Cindy's involved in this one. This is the newest thing I wrote, actually. It's called Corona Walk. Late afternoon walk with my wife, Cindy. Masks are in our pocket in case we can't socially distance during our saunter. At the apartment complex on the corner of Wigwam and Alvarado, a large man with a mask stands at the doorway and he yells at us, "You're supposed to be wearing one of these." "Shut up. We're just walking by ourselves. Mind your own business," I reply. Now he scurries up the stairwell and stares at us from one of the apartment windows. About 60 feet later, Cindy stops walking. "You know, he's challenged," she tells me. "Lives with his mom in one of those apartments, you moron," shaking her head. Shit, I reply. Then we continue our saunter. Finally, as you can see in most of my poems, I am the butt of most of my jokes. Again, this is my last one. I hope you enjoyed the evening with Jenith and I. I hope you buy our books through Bedlam. I hope you buy gift certificates for Bedlam. Nicole runs a really, really sweet bookstore there. The whole enterprise there at Compton is very nice. So we got to get small businesses back in the flow of things. And I've been associated with small businesses all my life, so I certainly can empathize. This was in Worcester Magazine, not this past Thursday, but the Thursday before. It's called Things I Plan to Do Once the Pandemic Finally Poops Out. It's numbered, because all great poems are. 1. Hug all my grandchildren. I have 9 grandchildren. Hug all my grandchildren. 2, cancel Netflix. Never watch CNN, MSNBC, and especially Fox News ever, ever again. 3, I'm gonna play miniature golf while listening to Willie Nelson with my sister-in-law, Susie, in God's country, New Hampshire, because she hates both endeavors. 4, I'm gonna enjoy a hash omelet at Annie's Clark brunch, and I'm gonna do that over and over again. 5, I'm gonna gamble at Plain Ridge Casino with our good friends, Connie and Sam, and I'm gonna rub the face of the slot machines like all those crazy people I make fun of do. 6, I'm gonna stop these goddamn 3-a-day walks. 7, I'm gonna wear a mask when I'm delivering babies at UMass Memorial Maternity when this all ends. Oh, I'm not an obstetrician. Never mind. 8, and I know he's watching me right now, I'm gonna fly to Tampa, Florida and gawk at Tom Brady's mansion from the lawn of our good friends, Patty and Mike Salakian across the bay. 9, I'm gonna enjoy the chicken parmesan with ziti at a table for one facing Shrewsbury Street at Delavo's Kitchen. 10, I'm gonna pick up all the goddamn litter in my Worcester backyard. Not gonna worry where it came from. 11, I'm gonna sit behind the guy with the huge head while enjoying a play at Hanover Theater. Now my daughter Amanda, who's on this, actually thought of this one because she sits behind me. This is an 8.25 here. 12, been a frequent Begelin Book Cafe, Roots and Press, Dorico's Market, and the many other small businesses in central Massachusetts. 13, I'm gonna drive my car across state lines just for the hell of it. 14, I'm gonna enjoy a Tanqueray and tonic poured secretly in a wine glass while having dinner with our good friends Lisa and Jim at La Cucina. 15, I'm gonna rejoin the three old white guys for Senior Wednesdays at Showcase Cinema, then share discounted pastries at the cafe shop in Millbury. And finally, 16, I'm gonna thank my wife Cindy for her patience and endurance while she worked at home and I meandered around the house since mid-March. Thank you, everyone. Hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you so much, Joe and Jenith. I'm struck by the pair of you in this reading, and I love that you live on the same street, because I love this balance and love the way, I think we've started a new trend now, because this is the second reading that we did sort of like a round robin, like one would read for a while, then another would read, and then another would read. I love it. So this, I think this, you guys are now setting the trend for the Bedlam readings. Thank you so much for coming, and I hope that this is somewhat of a balm during these times. I've been surprised how much I've really been loving these. So, you know, let me know if you have other thoughts or other things that you would like to see. Definitely feeling my way for new ways to do stuff as we go along. So thanks so much, everyone. And hope to see some of you for the open mic next week.